cell. And when each of us were born, me, you, we started out from a single cell. And then one cell became two, two cells became four, and suddenly you start to have a colony of cells. And they all came from the same mother cell, they're all the same family, but you can see that they're changing. And right now they're changing in color, but what that's showing us is they're changing in their generation. So now we have multiple generations of cells, and you start to see that some of the cells look bigger than the other, and they're a different color, right? They're yellow. And now we've got a whole colony of cells, a whole family of cells that came from one single mother cell. And they're all related to each other, and yet they're all different from each other. This is the challenge of working with cells in a variety of contexts. I show you the same story from that same movie of a single cell growing into a family of cells, but now in the context of what we call a lineage tree. So you see that red line at the top? That's that one mother cell at the beginning. And then she divides and has two twins. Those twins have twins, those twins have twins, and up to day four, you have this very symmetric, textbook-like family. But then after that, you have variety, and we call this heterogeneity. You have heterogeneity in this population of cells. They started out so uniform, a little factory chugging along to make more of itself, but now you have cells that stop dividing, they get bigger and bigger and bigger, and they never re-enter the cell cycle. This is a challenge of working with cells when you make them grow in your body or when you make them grow in the lab. So cells are the most sophisticated factory on Earth. This is the tip of a cell. You can see that it's making proteins of various kinds, small molecules of various kinds. You saw that it could even make another cell. And we use that creativity, that cell as a factory of other cells, a factory of drugs, so that we can make a single cell become a factory for us, like a bacterium, or we can make a collection of cells become something beautiful, like a plant, or we can make something as complex as a human. And even though this factory is very sophisticated. In fact, I will argue, as an engineer, that it's more sophisticated than an integrated circuit. It's more sophisticated than the fabs we make those integrated circuits in, even fabs as great and sophisticated as MIT Nano. But what happens when you age? What happens when you get injured? What happens when you want to repair your body? And these cells stop being the perfect factory. So when you have that situation where all the MIT nanos in the world cannot make that factory work in your body, you need to make more cells. You need to make a factory to make those factory of cells. And that is my dream, to take that idea that could become cell therapy, using cells to repair your body for a variety of diseases, but dealing with the reality that you have heterogeneity in this population. That when you make the cells proliferate outside the body, they will become different from each other, generation to generation. And sometimes that will not matter at all, but sometimes it really matters, and I'll illustrate that for you today. So each of these glyphs is showing you one colony of cells, one family of cells. The colors represent the generation. The size of those dots represent the size of the cells. The size of the colony is the size of the family, or how fast they proliferated. So when we think about cell therapy manufacturing, manufacturing cells, living cells as medicine, we need to deal with that complexity, that heterogeneity, if we're going to make cells become the drug factories we put back inside our body to repair ourselves. Now, these cells are mesenchymal stem cells. They came from your bone marrow. We could all donate them today. So these cells come from adults, and they're used to treat other adults. Or we could think about cells from our brain. There's also stem cells in our brain, and they could come from other people, or they could come from ourselves through new ways of engineering stem cell-like behavior. But we don't grow them right now in environments that are like your bone marrow or like your brain, we grow them in environments that look like this. So very simple and very flat and very transparent for many good reasons that biologists and engineers have invested in over the years, but so, so different from the factory that we would build if we wanted to control the cell behavior like we do in the body. So that is the challenge of cell therapy manufacturing. So when we think about this, you could think about having three options. And the three options that we have are option A. This is the current state of the art. This is saying we're going to take cells out of a human. Today, a human is a box with the word human written in the middle, but humor me. So the cells come out of the human, and we know that when we make them proliferate, as I showed you, they may become very heterogeneous. And let's just show that heterogeneity by having lots of different colors. But the state of the art is we put that now heterogeneous mixture of cells back into the body. And this happens whether the donor and the patient are the same person or the donor and the patient are from different families, different countries, different places on Earth. But what about option B? So option B says, well, I'm going to take the cells from the human, and I'm going to resign myself to the fact that when I grow them outside the body, they're going to become heterogeneous. But I'll build a machine, I'll build a device that could separate the cells to capture just the subpopulation that I want, just the cells that have the characteristics that make those cells good medicine, that make those cells perfect cell factories, that are perfect drug factories when I put them back in the patient. That would be option B. And we've illustrated that, I'll show you. And then option C would say, you know what, that's a really engineering brute force solution. You're just giving up that heterogeneity is going to occur and you're going to sort out the cells that you want. What if you try and understand where that heterogeneity comes from so well that you can manipulate the population of cells to make them all behave the same as they're increasing in number? And maybe you'll do that with materials, maybe you'll do that with food, maybe you'll do that with other pressures that you give them in the environment, but you'll allow them to increase in number without increasing in that heterogeneity or diversity. That would be option C, and we've illustrated that as well. So here's one way that you would illustrate option B. You would take a very simple device. What you're looking at here is a photograph of a spiral microfluidic device where the mixture of cells goes in the middle and the cell population that you want, just the cells that are the perfect drug for that particular disease, come out one of the outlets. And this approach was invented by my colleague Jay Han here at MIT, but for a very different purpose, for a purpose of separating out blood cells. And I said, Jay, we don't need to separate out blood cells, we need to separate out stem cells for cell therapy. So let's redesign that device. Let's think about that potential to have a clogless filter where, as illustrated here, a mixture of cells goes in the middle, and by pushing that fluid around in a centrifugal pattern, you're separating out cells that are different in terms of biophysical characteristics. Not necessarily biological characteristics, although it turns out that they also differ. But these cells will naturally separate on the basis of their cell diameter and also the stiffness of the cell. And those properties, although not biological, they're truly biophysical, correlate with whether those cells are going to be good medicine or not. And so we've translated that first into animal models, and now into human clinical trials. So let me show you just on the animals. Here, these are mice. And if you have a disease or an incidental exposure to radiation, where the key is to destroy your bone marrow on purpose, or the accident is to destroy your bone marrow inadvertently, what happens is all of the material in your bone marrow is wrecked. And as a result, the cells in your bone marrow, those mesenchymal stem cells, as well as your blood stem cells, they don't have the soil to thrive in. So this experiment is showing you that if you take mice and you irradiate them to the point where you've destroyed the bone marrow, They would otherwise lose the ability to then make new cells, which they need for their blood, which they need for their immune system. So you can see the population survivals on the vertical axis, and the number of days after intentional irradiation of the animals is on the horizontal. Now, that gray line is how long those mice are able to survive in the absence of any treatment. Radiation intentionally destroys the bone marrow, you lose your blood supply, you lose your immune system. And so those animals will not survive past about 12 days. The black line is the current state of the art. Here we're taking mesenchymal stem cells, but they turn out to be a mixture. So this is state of the art, or option A. And you can see that that produces some benefit, and that 20% of the mice survive. However, if you use this device, option B, to sort the cells, 80% of the mice survive. So just by selecting the right cells, even though they all biologically have markers of biological stem cells, we can see even better by creating these sorting devices and go have a fourfold increase in the number of animals that survive. So this is option B. One breakthrough in terms of cell therapy manufacturing is selecting the right cells to be the right medicine for the right disease. And then option C, understanding it well enough so that you can change what drugs the cells are secreting on demand so that when you put them into the human, they'll come to the right response. We've also been able to demonstrate, and that's shown here. So even more than 80% survival if you change the materials the cells are interacting with and you create an environment that is, in this case, more bone marrow-like. Okay, so we can illustrate this. This is in the realm of the future, and this is why we're so excited about scaling these approaches up. So that's when cells come from your bone marrow. But what if cells come from or need to go to your brain? This is particularly important in the context of aging and neurodegenerative diseases. And you can see from looking at this photograph or cartoon representation of the brain that it's very complex. It's very mechanically compliant, more compliant than Jell-O. It's topologically very complex. You can see there's folds in the material, there's white matter, there's gray matter. And that white matter is where we have myelin, where we have insulation around our nerves so that the signal conduction can go over long distances very quickly. But we don't grow cells, even stem cells from your brain, in an environment like this. We grow them in an environment like this. So maybe it's not surprising that when you're growing up cells that you'd like to use as cell therapy for the brain, you might not be able to keep all the features you want of those stem cells. And we said, as engineers, we think we can do better than what you see on the left and what you see on the right, that we can make something more similar, but it's going to take more materials, it's going to take more engineering. So this is what we've designed, and more specifically, this is what Anna and Daniela in my group have designed. Entirely new materials that are 3D printed. Now those red fibers that you see are 3D printed artificial axons. They're part of a nerve cell, the long part of a nerve cell that has to be insulated. And they are 100 times narrower than the hairs on your head. So these are very slender fibers, and they have the mechanical properties of the neurons in your brain. But by printing them, like you would print a very complex circuit, even though these are very different materials, you can have really amazing results with how they interact with cells, even the stem cells from your brain. But this is not your grandmother's 3D printer. So we had to design an entirely new 3D printer with Nick Yang and his Fang and his colleagues from MIT, and have entirely new materials so that we could 3D print these artificial axons. So here you're looking inside this new machine that is creating that environment to give us option C. So creating an environment where we can now produce cells that will be tricked into thinking that they're in an environment close enough to the body that we can make those cells into the drug factories we're looking for. So let me show you here what that looks like. Here you see these red artificial axons, and the green you see is what a biological cell that interacted with those artificial axons did. It, in fact, wrapped its processes, that myelin sheath, around the artificial axon, and that's the signature of insulation that you need to respond to neurodegenerative diseases. You can look at this top down, and the blue that you see is the nucleus of the cell where all the genetic information is. The green, however, is that myelin. So you can see that this particular cell wrapped 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 artificial axons. And that's also a hallmark of what happens in your brain tissue. One cell reaches out to many. That's why these cells are called oligodendrocytes, when they actually go from being a stem cell to a functioning myelinating cell. So let me show you this in real time. What you're looking at now is those oligodendrocytes. They were stem cells, but cultured in this environment, they began to differentiate. And what you can see, if you look where that white arrow is that this cell is wrapping its little tendrils around the artificial axon, exactly like you expect to see in the very first stages of myelination. So now we can, in real time, watch biological cells interact with the materials we've made to be artificial cells to understand the complex biological processes and to coax them in the direction that we want for cell therapy manufacturing. So it's approaches like these, options to sort cells, options to prime cells to become other cell types, that will be part of the tools in our toolbox for cell therapy manufacturing. This is how we'll address different kinds of cancer in the future. This is how we'll address different kinds of neurodegenerative diseases in the future. Not so that we can live forever, but so that we can live better, and so that we can live fuller lives. Thank you.